contours reflecting landforms. Landform is the basis of any landscape, forming the horizontal foundation upon which all else is arrayed. Landform is made up of various underlying geological substrates with diverse surface coverings, exposed rocks, soil, sand, gravel, synthetic paving, grass, leaf, litter, and so on. Usually, we don't see the essential material directly, but rather the covering, often vegetation, that forms the surface. Normally, the underlying material gives the characteristic shape and texture to landform. Two-dimensional representations. For landscape architects and others making 2D schematic drawings, a stylized conventional form of representing landscapes by spot elevations and contour lines is used. There are often the base data from which a digital model is created. Surveyors capture spot elevations and use mathematical formula to interpolate the elevation, shape, and location of contour lines. Most land surveyors produce data on landform by recording spot elevations at irregular intervals, attempting usually to capture important features in the landscape. High points, low points, center lines of ridges and valleys, top and bottom elevations of walls, elevations at the base of notable trees and structures, etc. Often each such point is identified by a unique label. These spot elevations represent the basic data structure from which most other terrain data is constructed. Elevation data may be gathered by other methods as well, including remote sensing by aircraft and satellites and orthophoto interpretation from pairs of overlapped aerial photographs. Now, let us discuss what are contours. Contours are the most common form of representation of terrain and a series of curved lines, each with a specified elevation set at a fixed vertical contour interval apart, representing lines of equal elevation, and they are called as isolines. The contour interval may vary from a few inches or fractions of a foot for detailed construction plans or very flat areas to tens of meters for large scale maps and more mountainous terrain. Contour plans may also incorporate spot elevations, especially at high points and low points, whose elevation would not otherwise be conveyed by the contours. These data sets are often derived from spot elevations for existing terrain or produced by landscape architects and engineers for new proposed surfaces. Contours can be extracted from Survey of India topographic maps, which are normally available on 1:250,000, 1:50,000, and 1:25,000 scale. The contour interval in these maps are 100 meter, 20 meter, and 10 meter. Topographical maps with lesser contour intervals can be obtained through photogrammetric surveys. Shuttle radar topographic machine and advanced space-borne thermal emission radiometer, they are the space-borne sensors, they provide contour maps with 90 meter and 30 meter contour intervals for the entire world. Since they are a conventional 2D representation, contours can be hard to understand except by trained professionals, and when projected into the three dimensions, tend to yield just so much spaghetti. Now, let us discuss the cross sections. Contour lines are limited to representing surfaces which are continuous in two dimensions, in which no vertical, overhanging, undercut, or multi-layered conditions can be adequately represented, except by confusing graphic techniques such as dotted lines, etc. Consequently, especially for site scale design, cross sectional drawings of terrain conditions are also often used. Contours are in fact themselves cross sections taken horizontally, most other cross sections are taken vertically at specified locations to reveal a side cut view. Terrain is rarely represented by real side views or elevations such as are used for the sides of buildings, etc., because terrain usually has few or no vertical faces. Cross-sectional drawings can be valuable for the generation of terrain surface and solid models by using a sweep operation or by continuously joining up or morphing between a series of cross-sections. This technique is especially useful for linear landform features such as roadways or drainage channels, in which cross-sections are given at regular intervals along a path or center line. Now let us discuss the three-dimensional terrain. With a digital model, one can represent terrain in its three-dimensional complexity and then generate either 2D or 3D visual representations for analysis or presentation. With a digital model, one can represent terrain in its three-dimensional complexity and then generate either 2D or 3D visual representations for analysis or presentation. There are varieties of 3D data structures that can be employed for the creation of a three-dimensional digital terrain model. Although real terrain is massive and solid with depth and volume, the starting point for most representation is to treat the ground as a surface. Now let us see the surfaces. A surface is a mathematical infinitely thin object with two sides, so that in a 3D view you can go beneath and see the backside. Terrain surfaces may be simple or complex, flat or rolling, shallow or steep. In the real landscape, landforms are constrained in their shapes and slopes by real world physical criteria such as the geologic makeup of the soil, the climate, vegetative covering, and other ecological concerns. In most digital models, these constraints do not automatically apply, but should be considered if the terrain being represented is to be subjected to real world influences. Simple planes. The simplest landform of all is just a flat plane. The next more complex is a tilted plane representing a sloping hillside. At least this minimum landform is required for modeling a landscape and provides a surface which can be used to locate other features such as trees or buildings, and on which those features can cast shadows. Often, to make sure that surface objects appear to be sitting upon the terrain, they are created with their base elevation just below the elevation of the terrain surface or plane, so that they are truly embedded in the surface. Grid mesh. While contour lines have appealing graphic qualities in 2D, they are somewhat complicated data structure to store digitally, as the data file must contain information about the connectivity of each point to its two neighbors. Keep track of multiple lines, each with its own Z value and so on. A far simpler and therefore more common data structure for a digital elevation model, especially for large areas such as the statewide and national coverage provided by the United States Geological Survey (USGS), is a raster grid, a rectangular array of numbers each representing the elevation, that is Z value, of the land at each point, that is XY, located on a regular grid. This form of digital elevation model, popularly called as DEM or DTM for digital terrain model, can be found at varying resolutions for most areas of the world from a variety of sources. The most important variable decision to make for these models is the size of the grid cell. If the grid size is too small, the file size may get enormous, rendering time will increase and the resulting image may be too dense with the lines. If too large a cell size is used, the surface may appear too coarse. Note that in a wireframe representation, in areas where the slope of the terrain is viewed obliquely and there is a greater density of lines or pixels on a computer screen, the greater density results in a darkening of the region, and in areas where the faces are viewed more head-on and there is less density of lines or pixels, there is a corresponding lightness. This gives a sense of shading to the image so produced, but this shading has nothing to do with lighting or light or shade and is in fact quite artificial and may be even be misleading. Now, ruled surfaces. Another simple and direct method of generating a 3D surface model from contours is to create a ruled surface generating 3D faces between adjacent pairs of contour lines. If each contour line is a 3D isoline, that is a polyline with a constant z value, one simple approach consists of connecting each vertex point on the first line with an appropriate number of points on the second line to form a series of quadrilaterals or triangles which together create a band of connected 3D faces. Since each point on each line is used in this method, there will be continuity across contour lines and no gaps. The biggest trick to this method is determining for each pair of lines the appropriate number of points on the second line to connect to each point on the first. If the number of points on each line happens to be identical, then the choice is simple and a series of rectangular, trapezoidal or lozenge shaped quadrilateral faces will be created. If the numbers are unequal, especially if they are greatly unequal, then a series of triangles will be created. Now, let us discuss in detail about the landforms. The shape of land is shown by means of very detailed contours, aided by the special symbols for small knolls, depressions, etc. This is complemented in black by the symbols for rock and cliffs. Orienting terrain is normally best represented with a 5-meter contour interval. Excessive use of form lines should be avoided, as this will complicate the map and give a wrong impression of height differences. If the representation of an area needs a large number of form lines, a smaller contour interval provides a more legible alternative. The relative height difference between neighboring features must be represented on the map as accurately as possible. Absolute height accuracy is of less importance. It is permissible to alter the height of a contour slightly if this will improve the representation of a feature. This deviation should not exceed 25% of the contour interval, and attention must be paid to neighboring features. The contours are line joining points of equal height. The standard vertical interval between contours is 5 meters. The smallest band in a contour is 0.25 millimeter from a center to center of the lines. Index contours. Every fifth contour shall be drawn with a thicker line. This is an aid to the quick assessment of height difference and the overall shape of the terrain surface. Where an index contour coincides with an area of much detail, it may be shown with a normal contour line. Form line. An intermediate contour line. Form lines are used where more information can be given about the shape of the ground. They are used only where representation is not possible with ordinary contours. Only one form line may be used between neighboring contours. Slope line. Slope lines may be drawn on the lower side of a contour line. Example, along the line of a re-entrant or in a depression. they are used only where it is necessary to clarify the direction of slope. Contour values may be included to aid assessment of large height differences. They are inserted in the index contours in positions where other detail is not obscured. The figures should be oriented so that the top of the figure is on the higher side of the contour. Earth bank. A steep earth bank is an abrupt change in ground level which can be clearly distinguished from its surroundings. Example, gravel or sand pits, road and railway cuttings or embankments. The tags should show the full extent of the slope but may be omitted if two banks are close together. Impassable banks should be drawn with symbol. The line width of very high earth banks may be 0.25 millimeter. Earth wall, distinct earth wall, minimum height is 1 meter. Small earth wall, a small or partly ruined earth wall shall be shown with a dashed line, minimum height is 0.5 meter. Erosion gully. An erosion gully or trench which is too small to be shown by a symbol is shown by a single line. The line width reflects the size of the gully, minimum depth 1 meter and the end of the line is pointed. Small erosion gully. A small erosion gully or trench, here the minimum depth is 0.5 meter. Knoll. Knolls are shown with contour lines. A prominent knoll falling between contour lines may still be represented by a contour line if the deviation from the actual contour level is less than 25%. Small knoll, a small obvious mound or rocky knoll which cannot be drawn to scale with a contour, that is diameter of mound less than 0.5 meter. The height of the knoll should be a minimum of 1 meter from the surrounding ground. The symbol may not touch a contour line. Elongated knoll. A small obvious elongated knoll which cannot be drawn to scale with a contour, that is length less than 12 m and width less than 4 meter. The height of the knoll should be a minimum of 1 meter from the surrounding ground. Knolls larger than this must be shown by contours. The symbol may not be drawn in free form or such that two elongated knoll symbols overlap. Now let us see the depression. Depressions are shown with contours or form lines and slope lines. Prominent depressions falling between contour lines may be represented by a contour line if the deviation from the actual contour level is less than 25%. Small shallow natural depressions and hollows, that is minimum diameter 2 meter, which cannot be shown to scale by contours, are represented by a semicircle. Minimum depth from the surrounding ground should be 1 meter. Location is the center of gravity of the symbol, which is oriented to north. Then pit and holes with the distinct steep sides which cannot be shown to scale by symbol. Minimum diameter is 2 meter. Minimum depth from the surrounding ground should be 1 meter. Location is the center of gravity of the symbol which is oriented to north. Broken ground. An area of pits or knolls which is too intricate to be shown in detail. The density of randomly placed dots may vary according to the details on the ground. Special landform features. This symbol can be used for a special small landform features. The definition of the symbol must be given in the map legend. Now let us discuss the topic data analysis and mapping. Analysis of data is a process of inspecting, cleaning, transforming and modeling data with the goal of discovering useful information, suggesting conclusions and supporting decision making. Data analysis has multiple facets and approaches encompassing diverse techniques under a variety of names in different business, science and social science domains. Data mining is a particular data analysis technique that focuses on modeling and knowledge discovery for predictive rather than purely descriptive purposes. Business intelligence covers data analysis that relies heavily on aggregation, focusing on business information. In statistical applications, some people divide data analysis into descriptive statistics, exploratory data analysis popularly called as EDA and confirmatory data analysis called as CDA. EDA focuses on discovering new features in the data and CDA on confirming or falsifying existing hypotheses. Predictive analytics focuses on application of statistical or structural models for predictive forecasting or classification, while text analytics applies statistical, linguistic and structural techniques to extract and classify information from textual sources, a species of unstructured data, all or varieties of data analysis. Data integration is a precursor to data analysis, and data analysis is closely linked to data visualization and data dissemination. The term data analysis is sometimes used as a synonym for data modeling. Now, data mapping. In computing and data management, data mapping is the process of creating data element mappings between two distinct data models. Data mapping is used as a first step for a wide variety of data integration tasks, including data transformation or data mediations between a data source and a destination, identification of data relationships as part of data lineage analysis, discovery of hidden sensitive data such as the last four digits social security number hidden in another user ID as part of a data masking or de-identification project, consolidation of multiple databases into a single database and identifying redundant columns of data for consolidation or elimination. Hand-coded graphical manual. Data mapping can be done in a variety of ways using procedural code, creating XSLT transforms, or by using graphical mapping tools that automatically generate executable transformation programs. These are graphical tools that allow a user to draw lines from fields in one set of data to fields in another. Some graphical data mapping tools allow users to auto-connect a source and a destination. This feature is dependent on the source and destination data element name being the same. Transformation programs are automatically created in SQL, XSLT, Java programming language or C++. These kinds of graphical tools are found in most ETL tools, that is extract, transform, load tools, as the primary means of entering data maps to support data movement. Data driven mapping. This is the newest approach in data mapping and involves simultaneously evaluating actual data values in two data sources using heuristics and statistics to automatically discover complex mappings between two data sets. This approach is used to find transformations between two data sets and will discover substrings, concatenations, arithmetic, case statements, as well as other kinds of transformation logic. This approach also discovers data exceptions that do not follow the discover. Semantic mapping. Semantic mapping is similar to the auto-connect feature of data mapping, with the exception that a metadata registry can be consulted to look up data element synonyms. For example, if the source system lists first name but the destination lists person given name, the mapping will still be made if these data elements are listed as synonyms in the metadata registry. Semantic mapping is only able to discover exact matches between columns of data and will not discover any transformation logic or exceptions between columns. I hope you found this lecture very useful. Thank you.